experiment. Simplest area we have. Let's bring it back. What's that link? Square root 2, exactly. Old star. So we want to know what this link is, and seemingly, if you're a Pythagorean, you say, well, it's a link we can construct, right? We can draw it. It comes out of some structure we know. It has to be some fraction. the speculation was that it was murder. No. Why would we think that the scientist was murdered? It was 1601. Think about that time frame. Some thought that it was his cousin Eric, Christian IV of Denmark, because it was thought that Brahe was having an affair with his mother, the Queen of Denmark, in 1601. This was right around the time when Hamilton was written. But no, it wasn't there. Well, if he was murdered, was it his assistant, Johannes Kepler? Kepler was Brahe's apprentice, and Kepler certainly had a lot to gain from his mentor's death.
Yes.
1% of Denmark's wealth, he had a sizable laboratory, and was notoriously secretive with his notes. But no, Kepler did get the lab. And all of the notes after his death, but basically, actually, what happened was Brahe was at a very long, drawn out party in Prague, and it was basically a breach of etiquette to leave the situation to relieve oneself from all the festivities, and so he ended up catching a bladder infection, dying a few days later. Pascal, mainly. was sickly over most of his adult life and died of tuberculosis at age, you can't see it, this is 39. Which is not terrible for 65, but still not so great. And this is actually the theme, the narrative that we see unfolding as we start to get more accurate histories about magicians as time goes on. You tend to see these themes repeating in the modern era, that a mathematical prodigy that changes history has a life full of familial and religious strife and sickness and often a young man. So we'll move on from ancient murders to modern TVs. And now I'm going to jump us to the 19th century. We'll talk about a few mathematicians that made leaps and bounds beyond our understanding. We'll start us with the race of Galois. If you can hear me well, yeah, you can't see that. But the years there, 1811 to 1832. So I'm talking about someone that changed the face of mathematics and died from his tree. Privileged French man, actually, had some money to begin with. Dad's a liberal mayor, mom's a classicist. He was a genius. He went to college at age 10. But his mother decided to keep him here. Couldn't get into the Polytechnique because he either went to school or he couldn't explain his answers to his oral exam. He just knew that he was right. So he ended up at the equivalent of now. As far as the family strife, his father committed suicide in 1829 after a political dispute. He applied to the Polytechnique again, didn't get in, same situation, wouldn't explain his answers, the exam proctor didn't understand what he was saying, and throwing in a razor on the proctor's head. But not only could he not get into the Polytechnique, he wrote a paper, could not get it published because his credentials weren't so high. But he did take this notion of irrational numbers and kind of expand his usefulness in some incredible way. So if we look at this simple equation, x squared minus 2 equals 0, you see that there's some kind of symmetry involved. Right? There are two solutions, positive square root and negative square root. Of course, I don't have the time to give you an entire course in algebra at this point. But Galois, if you have studied mathematics at all, you know there is an entire field named after Galois theory, which is based in understanding the symmetries involved in solving these kinds of equations. was able. His mother died in 1820 after losing his blood opposition. So, and then we get feedback. So we have Ramanujan.
Some here is called the Ramanujan sum.
David Hilbert, who is also very well known for his contributions to functional analysis and other fields, said, no one shall expel us from the paradise that Cantor has created. Hilbert is known for putting together a list of problems that he presented in 1900 in Paris to say, this is what we need to understand. killed soon after 2000 when it was renamed the Edo Doeblin lemma because he actually proved it first. Now, from Doeblin we moved to Alan Turing, and I figure that at least in the last couple of years you're a little more familiar with Turing than you may have been 2 years ago. Alan Turing, one of the founders of the capability theory of artificial intelligence, built on Polish research, working to crack the German Enigma codes. And along with him and his folks have pledged the war to take care of it. But what I want to focus on at this point is that narrative that I'm building. So, with all of his work in logic, we have a letter that Turing sent home to a friend named Norman Routledge, where he stressed that his sexual orientation, which was not legal in England at the time, would be problematic for his research, unfortunately. So the quote here is, "I'm rather afraid that the following syllogism may be used by some in the future. Turing believes machines think. Turing lies with men, therefore machines do not think." It's a problematic contradiction that he was using a bit tongue-in-cheek, but understood that his work was not necessarily going to be appreciated by the government that he was doing it for. End result was, after World War II, was arrested on charges of gross indecency. At this point, there is a film called The Imitation Game, which is based on Andrew Hodge's biography of Turing. So you can see a dramatization of this. But the truth is, he was sentenced to a loss of security clearance and underwent chemical castration and died at age 41. Now, it's interesting, the work that he was working on at this point was no longer mathematics. He had decided to shift fields to biochemistry. And so, while he was working with cyanide, which was his cause of death, whether or not there was any intent behind it, was that he
cited A Beautiful Mind as an example of the trope of the mad mathematician. So do you figure John Nash would fit into your narrative? John Nash was a real person.
John Nash was absolutely a real person, and much more recent than most of the people that I mentioned here. I only stayed a little bit away from Nash because he kind of played in between math and economics. And he got a movie, right? So I kind of stayed away from people that had those narratives that you can already see pretty readily. But I just haven't read much about his life, so I don't know if it can be turned in that way. Certainly, it was turned well enough to be a major motion picture.
Yep. Well, so it's Imitation Game.
Right. But as far as the mad part of the mad mathematician, certainly I'd say Nash fits it better than Turing, because Turing is a rather stable guy most of the time. Nash does fit a little better. Yes?
You talk about math being stigmatized and how the stigma seems to be fading away. Well, remember in the 90s how they had a talking Barbie that said math class is tough?
Yes.
And now we've got Danica McKellar from Wonder Years, coming up best-selling author with books about mathematics. Would you say it's a major step forward?
I want to say it's a step forward, but the more you look at that material, I mean, I do kind of have issues with Kiss My Math and things of that nature. It's kind of turning it into this very cutesy thing. It's making it accessible in the way that a particular demographic may read their math textbook and then read Cosmo, and that's a bit problematic.
fiction, like there's science fiction. Never heard of that? Now, before everyone goes, I have one more announcement to make. The next Mensa lecture series will be at this room on March 17th. Our speaker will be documentarian Kimi Callahan. And that's rather appropriate because March 17th is St. Patrick's Day, and the surname Callahan is very appropriate. Of course, she would also be suited for April because that's the month of Anzac Day. Australia and New Zealand, and her first name is Kiwi, so if you don't know what Anzac Day is, I advise you to look it up. It's a big holiday in Australasia. It commemorates the first time Australian and New Zealand soldiers fought in battle together at the Battle of Gallipoli in World War I. But that's 2 months away. Thank you for coming to this lecture. Hope to see you next month. Be sure to tell out all your friends, and we're still looking for speakers from April onward, so if you or someone you know would make a good addition to our lecture series and join such illustrious greats who have come here to speak previously, please let me know. Thank you. Good to see you.
Yeah, I'm from New Zealand too, so my days in Yemen.
Good.
Thanks, man.
You're welcome. I'm looking. Yo.